पूरा स्टार्ट।
नमस्कार, गुड इवनिंग, खमा खरी। इंडिया देखो के सीरीज 8 एपिसोड 8 में आप सभी का स्वागत है। आई फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल आई वुड लाइक टू थैंक यू फॉर ऑल योर सपोर्ट दैट वी आर एबल टू कम ऑन द 8th एपिसोड। आप सभी का मैं तहे दिल से शुक्रिया करना चाहता हूँ। इट इज ऑल विद योर ब्लेसिंग्स एंड दी विद ऑल योर ब्लेसिंग्स दैट वी आर स्टार्ट रनिंग दिस 8th सीजन 8th एपिसोड। टुडे एज यू ऑल नो We are talking about tea. Tea is a subject like आप सभी अपने घर में चाय बनाते हैं and सबका हम Indians का it is tea is like it's part and parcel of our life. So let's talk about tea and on this session we have a guest speaker Ms. Susmita Das with us and she'll take us to the various tea estates of the country and we'll be tasting the various teas and the flavors of the tea. So I welcome Ms. Susmita Das. So she is born and brought up in Calcutta and about her family, her father used to go in the market and used to take finest tea from the tea vendor, taking it from the starting from the boxes they used to tell that give us the best tea. So this was like about this thing about the tea, and her mother used to brew like in an English or British kind of thing. Her mother used to brew the tea in her house, and the smell motivated her to start her journey as a tea blogger. So she started her company, Smart Ideas, a marketing and a social media marketing company, where she was working for a tea brand. And from this, her journey of tea blogging and tea tasting started, and she started traveling to the various regions of India, exploring the tea gardens and all. So I welcome Ms. Susmita Das on the board.
Hello.
Yes. Welcome on board.
Yes, thank you so much for inviting me here. Before I start, I just want to clarify that my name is Susmita Das Gupta and not Susmita Das, because Das Gupta is one surname. And thank you for the introduction. Yes, I grew up drinking very good tea. I come from Calcutta, though I'm settled in Bangalore now. I have grown up drinking finest tea from Darjeeling and Assam. But now, of course, I work with all the tea estates in India, in terms of trying their teas and recommending their teas. Yes. So should we start now?
Yeah, we can start the thing.
All right, great. So I am going to screen and I'm going to start with a small story and then move into the final presentation thing. It's not a presentation, it's more about sharing some of the things that I have experienced with traveling in different parts of the country and the estates. So I'll share some of those experiences. And in the process, I will also tell you what are the things that I have learned about and a little bit of stories around tea as well. So, Ulu has created a fantastic poster. So I thought I will start with a little story on the poster. Everybody can see the video now, the presentation?
Your screen is not visible.
Okay, just give me a moment. Yes, I'm opening it.
Please share your screen. Yeah, it's there.
Yeah, yes. So this is a beautiful picture, which, this is a picture from Kunur. Kunur is in the Nilgiris, for people who are not aware of. And this is very near to Ooty. So Kunur is about 18 kilometers from Ooty. And when you are traveling from Bangalore, Ooty comes first, then Kunur comes. When you are traveling from the Tamil Nadu side, Kunur comes first, and then Ooty comes. So this is a particular estate called the Tiger Hill Estate. This is, and this particular estate is known for its sunrise. So on this date, when I was traveling, the sun was rising. This is in February this year. The sun was supposed to rise between 5:30 and 5:45. And I had a few of my friends also staying in the bungalow, in the Tiger Hill bungalows, picture I will show later on. And we were waiting for almost 30, 35 minutes in the cold. It was like almost 6 degrees, you know, Celsius. And we were all sitting to take the picture of sunrise. And by the time the sun had risen and all my friends had took the picture, this is the time I got to actually take this picture. So this is the actual teapot that we're using to drink our tea, make our tea. And this is the picture that we took, I took. It was composed in a way to make the teapot more visible. And it came out well. Thanks, Kunjon, for making this picture, you know, well aware among your network and friends. So today's topic is Tea Time Talk. Now, we are starting this around 7:17, which is not exactly a tea time. But if you go back to the Victorian time in the United Kingdom, this is actually a time between 7 and 8 when the household workers or the the people who were working outside the home, not the aristocrats, but the working class people, this is the time for them to sit down in their house with a mug of tea and have their dinner. So this is the tea that we know as high tea. So high tea is something where the working class people will sit in their kitchen tables, which are high tables, with their dinner and a mug of tea, and drink the tea with the food. So this is a perfect tea time talk that way. It is a high tea talk and not an afternoon tea talk. Afternoon tea happens at around 4 o'clock with small eats and not the dinner or lunch. But high tea happens around 8 o'clock with the dinner. So yeah, perfect for people who are having their dinner or are going to have the dinner. So this is a good time to do this kind of talk here. Now, let's get into the idea about what is tea. So I'm going to show some pictures. And this is a picture you can see. It's called blue flower, butterfly tea flower, actually, these are called. Then this is another picture, this is another picture, and this is another picture. So these are all the pictures. Now you might be thinking, are they all teas? The answer is yes, these are all tea. These are all different kinds of tea that I'm going to talk about. And some of them you can see that in many of the pictures, there are no tea leaves. But in some pictures, the last picture you can see, there are some tea leaves. But most of the pictures do not have tea leaves. So there are teas which does not have tea leaves. But why are we talking about tea as such? To be very fair, in fact, why are we not talking enough about tea? That's my question. Because tea is globally the second most taken beverage after water. If you can call water the beverage, then it is the second most consumed beverage. If you do not take water as an average, then this is the number one beverage in terms of per capita as well as the amount of tea that is being taken across the globe. So tea is very important. Number two, in India, we produce some of the best teas in the world. When I say best teas in the world, some of the teas that we produce fetch prices to the extent of about 2 lakhs rupees per kilo, up to the 2 lakhs rupees a kilo. So it is very comparable to the wine that the French produce. So So if French people are so proud and happy about their wine, we as an Indian should also be very happy and proud about our tea, because our tea is better or comparable to any good wine in the world. Now, tea is most similar to wine and has got absolutely nothing in terms of similarity or characteristics with coffee. Coffee is a very independent kind of a beverage. So there is no competition between tea and coffee. I like coffee, I drink coffee. People who drink coffee also drink tea. But there is a lot of similarity between how between tea and wine, and how the appreciation and tasting, etc., happens. So tea is more comparable to good wine. Our teas are well known across the globe. You name any royal houses, like the Japanese royal houses, the British royal houses, the Danish, the Swedish, the Saudi Arabian, all of them in the morning, they drink our tea. So this is a tea that everybody drinks. In fact, if you can take hold of a menu at the Buckingham Palace, the morning rituals, the morning breakfast rituals mandates that you drink English breakfast tea. That is the tea that is served at the menu as a breakfast at the Buckingham Palace for everybody, including the Queen. And English breakfast tea is nothing but a blend of our Assam tea and the Nilgiri tea. So tea is very, very interesting subject, very important subject. And because of the health importance about tea, it has got so much of good health benefits. In many European countries, they are moving away from wine as a daytime drink and replacing it with tea. Of course, in the evening, people prefer to drink alcohol, including wine. But in the morning, when they were having a glass of white wine or red wine with their lunch, they are slowly replacing that with tea. And the interesting part about tea is that when tea originated as a drink long time back, in India almost 7,000 years back, in China almost 3,500 years back, it started off as a medicinal drink. So, am I audible? Gunjan?
Yes, you are audible. Very much audible.
All right. So there was so much of silence. I was, for a moment, I thought that, we have lost each other.
No. Before we go on to it, so the journey till now, it was like we just thought ki what is all tea about. We just learned that ki chai hoti kya. Hum log jo bolte chai, it's like what is all about chai. So let's talk in brief about the history of the tea, or in Hindi we say chai, and how it came into origin, and how we see it in the ancient culture. Over to you, Susmita.
Yes. So before I move on, let me explain that tea and chai are very different things. So I'll explain what is the difference and how that difference happened. Now, it is interesting that in China, it is not called tea. In China, it is called cha. And in Bengali, in my language, also it is called cha. Now, in South India, if you travel, they do not call it chai, they call it tea. In South Indian languages, if you go to Tamil or Malayalam or Kannada or Telugu, they do not have the word chai. They do not say chai or cha, they always call it tea. Okay, and if you go to Dutch, if you go to Netherlands, in Netherlands is the first country in Europe who started drinking tea, and they do not call it tea, they call it cha. The tea is a word that is used by the British and some parts of other colonies, which were other countries or regions which are colonies of British. Now, if I come back to the history of it, let me explain. I'll tell you how tea and chai is different in India, but let me just start with the history. So if we all know the stories of Ramayana, Mahabharata, and we know that there is something called Somrasa. Somrasa is something which gives you eternal youth and you do not die. And there are researches done by people which claims that somras was nothing but a herbal drink from ancient India, which is chai. It's a herbal drink, it's a herbal chai. There are instances in Ramayana where they say that when Lakshman was injured by the arrow, when they were fighting with at Sri Lanka with Indrajit Meghnad, and he was very badly injured, Lord Rama had sent Hanuman to bring some herbs from the Himalayas. And that herb, which is called the Bishallokarani herb, is also considered a tea. It's a herbal tea which has the power of healing people who are almost at the verge of death. So that is the history that starts from India mythologically from the time of Ramayana. In China, the tea was invented, sometimes discovered, not invented, sometimes around 4,000 years back. The story says that the emperor was Shen Nang. He was sitting under a tree in the afternoon, and his servant had served him a hot bowl of water to drink. And when he woke up, he had seen a couple of leaves floating into the water. When he took the cup up to his nose to smell, he liked the smell of that water with the leaf in that. So he drank it, and after he drank it, he felt extremely rejuvenated. And later on, that plant became the tea plant. So actually he was sitting in a tea plantation, which he didn't know, and he made a ruling in his country, in his region in China, that water henceforth has to be taken with this leaf. Now it was not called cha at that time in China. It was still considered called a herbal plant, but that's how they started drinking in China. Even in India, in the courts of Harshavardhan and Ashoka, there are instances where a herbal drink has been given to the guests coming from different parts of the world. And that's about 2,500 years back in India. Now, there's also another story that actually tea originated in India, and it is the Buddhist monk Bodhisattva who took the tea plant and took it to China, and that's how China got their tea plant. So there are a lot of stories around that. But the recorded history, these are all not recorded history, other than nothing here is recorded history, but these are all folklore and mythology and things that we believe. But the recorded history in India shows that there is a place in Assam where the local tribe called the Singpo tribe knew about tea plants, and they were using the tea plant as a vegetable, like a saag, like a spinach, and they were cooking the tea leaves as part of their vegetable. Now, this is the ancient India, ancient history. Now, let us come back to the time when it actually became well known to the European countries. So, Dutch was the first, the Netherlands is the people, are the first people who got to know about tea, because they started doing business, the Dutch East India Company that started doing business with China, and they bought the green tea from China. And they started selling it in Europe. So in Europe, it's the Dutch people who started drinking tea. Then the French got introduced into the tea, and it became the drink of the elite people, because tea was extremely, extremely expensive. It was not common people couldn't have afforded to even drink tea. So it was elite people, the royal people, who were drinking tea in Europe those days. And then it got introduced to Britain, and it got introduced to Britain because one of the kings of Britain got married to somebody from Netherlands, and she bought a chest of tea with her as a dowry, and that's how the British people got used to the concept of tea, and they loved it so much they thought that we now have to import it from China. Now, these are some of the things that happened post that introduction to tea, but British being British, they always wanted to take things from somebody else which did not belong to them. So they decided to bring the tea leaf from China and plant it somewhere and make their own plantation, because the amount of tea that they were buying, their balance of trade was becoming negative, you know, for China. But Chinese people were very, very strict about that. It was their secret leverage. They will never part it away. So the Opium War started, and the British, in the meantime, they sent some spies, some British intelligence officers. They went to China. They smuggled some tea plants, seeds and leaves, and they came to India in Calcutta, and they thought that we will try it out and cultivate these in Calcutta. So they put the tea seeds in Calcutta Botanical Garden, which is now called Botanical Garden, which is in Howrah, which is a twin city of Calcutta. And the tea did not grow. Of course, the region, the topography, the weather were not same. The tea did not grow. So they were very heartbroken. So this is the story up around in the middle of 19th century. Now, at this time, when these things were happening in Calcutta, when these British officers were sadly discussing their failure of growing tea in Calcutta in a club and sipping some whiskey or something, this gentleman called Maniram Diwan heard the story, you know, with these officers talking about it. And he came and said, "Can I see the things you are talking about? Can I see the leaves? Can I see the seed you are talking about?" And the officers showed him the leaves and the seed. And he said, Maniram Diwan said, "Hang on, it looks like we have this exact tea plant, an exact plant in my backyard at home in Assam." So the officers were very taken aback. So they said, "Is it so? Let us go to Assam and see whether he is telling not the correct thing or not." So they went to Assam and they found that indeed Assam has this particular kind of tea, particular kind of plant, which is quite similar to the Chinese tea. So the Chinese tea, the chemical name of Chinese, the botanical name of Chinese tea is Camellia sinensis, and they called this, because it is from India and from Assam, they made a variation in that and called it Camellia sinensis assamica. So this Camellia sinensis assamica is an indigenous tea plant of Assam. Now, what these officers then did, the Assam then becomes the first tea estate, and he becomes one of the first private Indian tea planter in Assam. Then from there, they moved to Darjeeling and they planted the Chinese tea leaves and the seeds that got from smuggled out of China in Darjeeling. So in Darjeeling, we have the Chinese variety of tea, and in Assam, we have the Assamic variety of tea, which is the indigenous tea. So if you visit Darjeeling, they will say China plant, or they will call it clonal. Clonal is nothing but the clones created out of the original China bush. So in Darjeeling, you will find the original tea that had come from China. And the Assam variety of tea, that same variety was taken to southern India in Munnar and Nilgiris, and it grows there. From there, it went to Sri Lanka. From there, it went to in Kenya. And in all these places, it is the Assamica variety of tea that grows. In India, in Darjeeling, and in Kangra, Himachal Pradesh, it is the Chinese variety of tea that grows. So in the world, there are two varieties of tea, the Chinese variety and the Indian varieties. All the tea plantations that you see across the globe in India, Sri Lanka, Japan, Korea, Vietnam, Kenya, they have either the Chinese variety or the Indian varieties. However, it was very difficult for Indians to get used to this, because they thought it's a British product. So they were not really warming up to the idea of drinking tea. But slowly it moved. They did put a lot of effort in making tea popular. And after independence, when the Tea Board of India was set up, they did a lot of promotional activities. And that's how the tea became a household name only during the 1960s. Before that, when somebody visited your home, the welcome drink was either milk or buttermilk, or a lassi or something like that. So tea was not really a welcome drink until about 1960s. Now, in between the British, what they did was that they wanted to have a quick tea, which is easy to make, because a tea making process takes almost 24 hours. And it was a big cash crop for them. They were earning thousands of pounds by selling tea from India across the globe. But it was taking time to manufacture because it takes 24 hours to make one batch of tea. So one intelligent British officer created a system called the CTC. CTC, in the CTC tea, you only make black tea and you can have the black tea in about 2 hours. So they could have, in 24 hours, they can have 12 batches of tea, and they started selling this tea across the globe. Of course, they did not sell the CTC tea in Britain, because Britain would never drink CTC tea. They will only drink the original orthodox whole leaf teas. So in the poorer countries, like in Africa, in Middle East and other places, they started selling, even in India, they started selling CTC, and all the good tea started going out of India. And it is sadly say the same case as of now. India drinks most of the CTC tea, and most of the good whole leaf tea goes out of India, and are more popular now in Europe, North America, and in the Middle East. All right, so now we come to the tea growing regions of India. So there are 5 geographic indications registered for tea. So that means, like in Champagne, it is the wine and the grapes that grows in the region of Champagne is called Champagne, and nobody else can call it a Champagne. Same way, if it grows in Darjeeling, then only it is a Darjeeling, and nobody else can call it a Darjeeling tea. So Darjeeling, Assam, Kangra, Himachal, Kangra, Munnar, and Nilgiris, these are the 5 GI locations, GI indicating indicators registrations that India has. And these are brands, these are proper tea brands that we have. Now, besides these, there are other places like Sikkim has some extremely good tea. Their entire tea estate is organic. They're very good tea. In fact, I'm drinking some Sikkim tea at this time. There are some tea that grows in Uttarakhand. There are some tea that grows in Arunachal Pradesh, Meghalaya, Tripura also. But these are the 5 regions which people know globally, particularly the Darjeeling and Assam. These are the more popular ones. Darjeeling is called the champion of tea, as you have seen in one of my previous slides. And this fetches, the Darjeeling is the most premium, high quality tea that comes out of India. And next is Assam. Assam, of course, produces the highest number of tea in India. And Darjeeling is the best quality of tea coming out of India or anywhere else in the world. So it's a matter of pride that we have in India something, some teas called like the Assam tea or the Darjeeling tea or the Nilgiris tea or the Kangra tea, or the Munnar tea, and these are considered best of the best in the world. So it's a matter of pride for us. Now, these are the type of tea that we make in India. These are called white, green, oolong, and black. I will not get into the full details of it because this today's program is not about that. In China, there is another variety of tea that they make. It's called pua, but in India, we are still not making pua. And all these tea comes from the same plant. So it's not that one particular tea plant makes white, the other makes green and stuff. It's not like that. It becomes green, white, oolong, or black depending on the processing. How much processing has been done to the tea, that determines the kind of tea we are having. So if it is a very short process, then it is white tea, about 2 to 4 hours. If it is a long process, then it's a black tea. So it depends on the processing. So in between the other lies. So white is the shortest processing, black is the maximum processing time. And these are all orthodox tea, and orthodox teas are all leaf teas. So it's not CTC. And these are also called speciality teas. So as I said, orthodox or whole leaf teas are considered the speciality teas. And then there are herbal teas. You know, as I said, you remember I told you the story about Hanuman going and fetching the herbs from the Himalaya for Lakshman. So that is a herbal tea. In herbal tea, there are no tea leaves. like the Camellia sinensis I mentioned, that is a tea leaf, that the tea plant. So there is no tea leaf. These are herbs which are used as our herbs or spices or flowers and fruits, etc., who are infused in water to make herbal teas. The flavored teas, on the other hand, has tea leaf plus something else. So if you have a green tea and you mix a jasmine flower, or if you have a black tea, you mix rose petals, or if you have a white tea and you mix lemongrass, it becomes a flavored tea. All right. So this is a orthodox tea, a whole leaf tea. There's nothing else. You can see only the tea leaves. This is the herbal tea. All these things can be made into herbal teas. Ginger is a very good herbal tea, you know. And then this is the flavored tea. This is the jasmine with green tea. It's very popular. It's one of the most popular teas in China. And it was also getting very popular in India. Now let us come to traveling. So we now have understood a little bit of tea. Since I have mentioned about four geographic locations, I will also talk about the traveling experiences to those places. And we'll talk about some of the tea things from those places and share my own experiences of traveling there. So experiential traveling or immersive traveling is something that we are hearing these days very much. What is immersive or experiential? It is something which is not a checklist tourism. I call the checklist tourism is something where you have a list of things to do and you tick, 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 and see that you have done all those things. That's a checklist tourism. Now, checklist tourism is something where you do not really know anything about the local culture, local people, local norms, local custom, nothing. You just go visit and come back. Contrary to that, experiential traveling is where you really go and experience everything that is available there, from the food, the people, their customs, their culture, their heritage, everything that happens. You experience that not as an outsider, but as an insider who is coming there, spending the 4, 5, 6, 7 days, whatever days is there, completely immersed in the local way of living. So that is an experiential traveling, and that is something which is becoming really, really popular. So some of the examples that is happening globally about the experiential traveling, of course, now things are on hold, but by next year, second quarter, I think things will be better and we will all again start traveling and experiencing stuff. So these are some of the examples of experiential traveling. In India also, it happens in a very small way. People still do not, and Indians are not really known for experiences. They go to a place, they want their Indian food, they just see the places and come back. So Indians have to learn about experiential traveling. It will take them some time, but I'm hoping that they will learn about it. They will learn to experience the local food and not insist on having my dal chawal and etc. that they do everywhere they go, which is really annoying when you are traveling to some places and you only want your own food and don't even want to enjoy what the local people are to eat. So these are all part of the experiences. Food is a major part of experiential traveling. So is like customs, like attending a wedding or taking part in marriages and stuff, in celebrations and stuff like that. You see a lot of foreigners come to India to participate in holis. So that's an experiential traveling for them. Now, tea travel. Now, when I'm talking about tea, anyway, the tea estates are located in some of the fantastic locations in India. And then you mix it that with experiential traveling. So it becomes like the dream. Like, at least for me, it is like it's a dream. And people who are doing it traveling, the tea traveling, tea tourism, and tea trailing, they swear by it. There are a group of people who travel every year to different parts of the world in tea estates and just love it. So there are groups like that who does this kind of stuff. So this is one of the tea estate that you can stay when you're traveling in India. These are all the pictures that I'm going to show you now are from different tea estates. This is in Himalaya. This is somewhere, this is in Darjeeling. This is in Nilgiris. This is also in Darjeeling. Darjeeling, Darjeeling. This is also in Darjeeling. So what does traveling to tea garden means? Tea garden means there are a lot of activities that you do. In a tea traveling or a tea tourism, the main thing is that you stay within a garden. You stay within a garden in a tea bungalow. If the tea garden does not have a tea bungalow, or that region does not have a tea bungalow, you find something which is closest to the tea bungalows and you stay there. So the most important thing is that you are in the middle of a tea garden, either in a tea bungalow or something which is very close to a tea bungalow, and you participate in everything that happens in the tea bungalow, in the tea estate. For example, you can go and pluck tea with the women workers who are plucking. So this is from a picture that I had done plucking. Of course, this is my on the right, on the left hand side, you can see a green color stuff. So that's the tea bag where I was putting the thing. So you can also participate in that. You can do trekking. So this is a trekking in the tea garden. You can do trekking. You can do tea tasting. You can, you know, learn how to do tea tasting. This is a tea tasting inside the tea factory. And then, of course, everywhere you go, you can see this brilliant landscape and things which was always going to amaze you. So depending on where you are traveling, you can decide the itinerary, how you want to do stuff. So let's start with Assam. Assam, the unique thing about Assam is that Assam has the world's largest plain land tea plantation area. Most of the tea plantations or tea regions I'm going to talk about, they're all on the mountains. Assam is not. So Assam is the world's largest plain land tea cultivation area. And the other good thing is that because the Brahmaputra River goes through the Assam, along the Assam, all through, there are a lot of tea plantations and wildlife sanctuaries that overlap each other. So in Assam, the unique thing is that you can do tea tourism, then you can combine that with wildlife tourism, and you can combine that with river tourism. So there are a lot of things that can happen in Assam. So these are the green areas of the places where the tea estates are located: Upper Assam, Middle Assam, and Lower Assam. So most of the things are in the Upper Assam. And these are the places where all the wildlife sanctuaries are located. So you can see that in the Upper Assam, there are quite a few sanctuaries. You can see Kaziranga in the middle of it. And so if you are going to a location where you have a lot of tea estates in the Upper and the Middle Assam, you are going to be part of the wildlife tourism also. And you can very well take part in river tourism, where you can take a boat on the river and you can get down in some places, do some picnic, see some wildlife, again come back in the boat, stay for the night, you know, and again move up and down the boat to see things happening around it. So it's a pretty interesting and exciting stuff that you can do in Assam. In most of the places, because Assam is the first place where the British started tea estate, so most of the places have got some excellent tea bungalows where you can stay. And this is one of them. This is one of the tea bungalows where you can stay. It is called Wai Mashir, Balipara in Assam. And some of the things that you can do, this is how it looks like. And you know, if you like books and you just want to relax and stuff and just not do anything, so these are some of the things that are available in Assam to do. Now, Darjeeling is very close to my heart, not because I'm from Bengal, but because I grew up drinking Darjeeling tea, as Gunjan was mentioning. Now, Darjeeling has got these places, Karsiyong, Kalimpong, and Mirik, where tea is grown. Now, Darjeeling, to be called a Darjeeling tea, there are certain height in the Himalayas that the tea has to grow. Now, so all teas in Darjeeling are not Darjeeling teas. Let me repeat again, all teas in Darjeeling are not Darjeeling teas. There is a certain height above which, if the tea is grown, is called Darjeeling tea. So below that, there are other tea estates which falls under the Terai region or the Duas region, and those teas are also pretty good. But Darjeeling is of course known for the first flush tea, that is, which happens during the springtime. There's the first harvesting, March mid. Then it's also known for the second flush tea, which is also
some of the second flushes also have the muscatel flavor to that. So they're very well known tea. Carseo has got some of the most famous tea estates in Darjeeling. Now this is how the tea looks like in Darjeeling. This is the Chinese kind of tea. The leaves are, you know, short. The Assam variety has very long leaves. And this is how a second flush tea will look like in Darjeeling. It is a black second flush tea. And after the processing, this is how the tea looks like. So this is a Darjeeling. These are very expensive and very highly preferred tea, you know, globally. So this is a place which I like. I have stayed here a couple of times. This place is called the Cochrane Place. Cochrane, this is an old bungalow which belonged to Sir Perry John Cochrane, who was the magistrate of Carseo. Now, Carseo is known as the land of the white orchid. So if you're lucky to go there during the, you know, December and March, you can see plenty of white orchid in Carseo. It's a beautiful place, about 20-25 kilometers before Darjeeling when you were traveling up from Siliguri. Wonderful, nice, beautiful place. And this is right in the middle. In this, as you are entering Carseo, this resort comes here. Behind this Cochrane Place is an estate, tea estate, which belongs to the Ambotiers. It's called the Ambotier Tea Estate. And in front of it is there's another tea estate called the Mokaibari Tea Estate, which is the most famous, globally well-known tea estate from India. Mokaibari is known as the, it's actually the most well-known tea estate from India globally. They had made a record by selling tea at 1 lakh rupees a lot of years back, when tea were not known to be sold at that prices. So this is the entrance to the Cochrane Place. This is one of the rooms that you can see. And if this is the window, so I'll show you what comes from the window in a little bit. And this is what you see from the window. This is a Kanchenjunga. So if you are lucky and you are in the right season, you will see the Kanchenjunga right outside your window from the Cochrane Place. This is called the Glenaries. This is in Darjeeling Mall. If you are at Darjeeling, you're definitely are going to be at Mall. And this is the most famous tea house or tea room called the Glenaries. Here you get all the varieties of good tea along with very excellent food and pastries and cakes. So in this picture, you can see my mother at the extreme end, you know, sitting there. It's a must-go place. You know, if you're in Darjeeling, you are not going to Glenaries, then it's like you have not done something. This is a place called the Margaret's Deck. This is on the way from Carseo to Darjeeling, and it's done by the Goodrick Tea Company. It's a beautiful location. It is a deck, and it's like a protruding out of the mountain, and you can see the whole vista in front of you. It has got some excellent teas from Goodrick Gardens and some great food. This is inside the Margaret Deck. This guy is a French guy. He was in Darjeeling for about 6 months learning about tea, and we were having an impromptu tea testing session with him inside Margaret's Deck. This particular picture is that this is the tea that we had tasted. My mother and me were traveling, and we had tasted it from a Shamong tea estate called the Meribong tea estate. And this was the freshest produce. Like, they had just made this tea, the black tea, and we were sitting at the general manager's bungalow, and we had this tea with him. So very excellent memories that we had about this tea. You can look at the color. That's how a good Darjeeling second flush should look like. And this is the other side view of the Glenaries that I said in Darjeeling Mall you have to go. So this is how the Glenaries from the top looks like. Beautiful architecture, beautiful place, and a must visit if you're in Darjeeling. If you have not been there, then this is where you should be. Now, Sikkim was not part of the, is not part of the five regions, but I decided to include Sikkim because it's so beautiful. And I was quite mesmerized when I was there last year in November, attending the Cherry Blossom Festival in Sikkim. So this is the actual picture of the tea bungalow in Sikkim. It is in front of it is the mountain, and below that is the Tista River. So you can see the mountain as well as the Tista River. This is the other view of the same tea bungalow. This is where you stay. It's a beautiful place. And this is on the way to on the right hand side, that building, that is structure, you can see that is the tea factory building, Temi Tea. That is the tea factory. And on the other side, if you see far away, there is a peak. You can see like a mountain peak, the small white. So that is Kanchenjunga. So you can see the Kanchenjunga right from here. And this is the factory. This is the Temi Tea factory in Sikkim. It's an extremely picturesque and beautiful, beautiful, beautiful place. I have wonderful memory of being here. This is near Gangtok. Gangtok is about 5-6 hours from Temi, and this is in Gangtok. And here, the background, whatever you are seeing, is Kanchenjunga. So this is the site you can see in Sikkim. The Kanchenjunga is right behind you. Now, from North India, let us come down to South India. Munnar is in Kerala, is the, you know, it has the world's highest tea estate at 7,130 feet. And the unique thing about Munnar tea estate is that they also have this tea museum, which is the only tea museum in India. And if you are in Munnar is of course known as the honeymoon capital of India, but if you are traveling Munnar, please visit tea museum, because it's an excellent thing that they have done. And Kanandevan Tea Plantation is part of the Tata Group, so they have excellent facilities. They have done it really well. There's something called Srishti in here. Srishti is a handicraft division of this plantation, and they are people, the people with special needs. They make excellent stuff at Srishti. So Munnar is beautiful, as you know. It's just out of the world beautiful. And this is one of the clubs, the tea club. Not many people can stay here unless you know somebody in the tea estate or the plantation, but the experience is beautiful, pretty reasonable. And if you can stay here, and if you're interested to visit Munnar anytime when things get better, you can let me know, because you need somebody to know at the tea estate to have a room allotted for you. It's a very common sight in Munnar. Also in Nilgiris, we'll come to that. Very, very, very common sight. So Munnar, it's like about 1.5 hours drive from Cochin. And Cochin is very hot and sultry because it is on the Arabian Sea. But the moment you just drive about 1.5 hours, you reach Munnar, and you have the most wonderful weather. It's so beautiful, so wonderful. It's like, all year through 12 months a year, it has the beautiful weather. I was there sometimes in April last year, and at night the temperature fell to about 8 degrees Celsius. So it is very, very nice and pretty, taken from balcony. There are a lot of things that can be done in Munnar, a beautiful place. And from Munnar, you can go to Thekkery, which is a wildlife sanctuary. And then you can go to Alleppey and go to those Kumarakom and those places which are pretty well known in Kerala. So monsoon in Kerala. And Kerala is the cleanest state in the country. Kerala is the cleanest state. I particularly is not very fond of rains, because when it rains, the Indian cities becomes very dirty. I cannot go out and look into the dirt that happens due to rain. But trust me, when I went to Cochin and I went to Fort Kochi and Alleppey and stuff like that, I traveled to Kerala quite a lot, and I traveled there during the monsoon. It's the cleanest place you can find, even when it rains. It is just unbelievably clean. So it's an experience to visit Kerala, Munnar, all these places during monsoon. So nearby is the Nilgiris in Tamil Nadu. So Nilgiris, most of the tea plantations are in Kunnur, as I said, not in Ooty, which are very close to each other. So there are three major towns, Ooty, Kunnur, and Kotagiri. So you have the tea plantations in Kunur, and there are certain places in Kotagiri, and then the Ooty. Ooty doesn't have much of a thing in terms of tea plantations. Most of the things, the major, the good tea that come from Nilgiris come from Kunur. And Kunur is like my most favorite destination. Like if I am not feeling good, I go to Kunur. If I feel good, I go to Kunur. I have to celebrate something, I go to Kunur. I want to run away from work, I go to Kunur. I have to concentrate on my work, I go to Kunur. So Kunur is my runaway place, and it's like out of the world beautiful. And particularly the place where I stay, which is called the Upper Kunur, or the, you know, the Bedford area. So it's beautiful. This is one of the tea estates, very well-known tea estate in Kunur called the Glendale. And Glendale has a wonderful, wonderful tea bungalow. The prices are very, very competitive, very well maintained. And they have only 3 rooms. Of course, all the bungalows will have not more than 3 or 4 rooms. There you get cooked food. Whatever you order, they will cook for you and give. And stay inside a tea plantation. This is their office, actually, Nilgiris. This is their office, Glendale office, bungalow. Sorry, the office structure. This is the office. The office is also so beautiful. I had to take this picture and put it here. Now, this is another tea bungalow. This belongs to Avata. But here, you are not allowed to stay here unless you know the owner. It's a beautiful bungalow. It has got about another 3 rooms. So it is only the guest of the owners can stay here. If you want to stay here, just ping me. And this is a picnic that we did in Kunur. Inside the Glendale is a stream that you can see. And the surrounding is so beautiful that we decided that we need to have a picnic here. And that's how it started. We did that. Now, I have a video about Nilgiri tourism. I think Gunjan can show that. Gunjan, can you do that?
I do it. Just wait for a minute. I'll do it. Meanwhile, you can start explaining about the Nilgiris and all.
Yeah. Yes. So just put the tea, Nilgiris tea, this thing you have. So do you want me to do? I can do that.
I'll do it. I'll do it from here.
Do you want me to show the video?
You can continue with the video. Okay. Okay, please continue with the video.
Let me show it, then it is easier.
The video is not visible.
I am unable to show. I had sent you the link. Can you show that?
Okay. Thank you. I hope the video is visible.
Yes.
All right.
What a fantastic presentation of Nilgiris.
Yes. Yeah, it is. Great. Thanks. So I'll proceed with the, I have one more place left to show, Kanga. I'll proceed with that.
So viewers, I just wanted to say something that the session is a bit long, but it is going to be interesting. So don't leave, stay with us till the end.
Yeah, I think I have another 5 minutes max to go. So I showed you about this. So Kangra in Himachal, this is Kangra tea in Himachal, which is mainly in Dharamshala and Palampur. They used to be the best tea coming out from India during the late 19th century. In fact, sometimes during 1874 and 1880, two teas from Kangra won gold medal in Europe. So they were supposed to be the best teas coming out of India those days. Unfortunately, in 1905, they had a major earthquake and most of the tea factories were demolished. What was left were only some of the tea plantations and the they stopped working completely out of there. And it took almost 50, 60 years for the tea plantations and the tea industry in Kangra to come back to their old glory. And as of now, they have started making their tea. And again, they are some of the best teas that come from India. Now, as I said, this is located in Dharamshala and Palampur. These are the two places that the Kangra region occupies. So Dharamshala has the highest cricket stadium in the world, as you know, and this is that picture of the stadium. So when I visited Dharamshala with my family, this was one of the places that I thought I need to visit, because you know, we are all cricket lovers and it has a fantastic view all across. So this is my brother and me. This picture was taken by my nephew, so you know, we can see that, you know, we are still trying to pose, but the picture was taken. But anyway, we love this place. Now this is a place where one must visit when you are in Kangra. This is called the Kangra Fort, which is about 10-15 kilometers from Dharamshala. And this is the oldest dated fort in India. Now when I say oldest, the fort was built in 4th century BC. Let us just sing that, 4th century BC, and the fort is still standing. This fort was built by this family called the Trigatha Kingdom. Trigatha Kingdom has mentions in Mahabharata. So this fort is actually a link to the Mahabharata. Not only that, the river Vyas flows right in front of this, and the Alexander's troop had come up to river Vyas, and they wanted to attack this, but they decided to go back by seeing how strong this fort was. So there are a whole lot of nice, interesting story about this, and this is one of the oldest fortress in India, and the only one in the Himalayas. So this is a fascinating place. If you're in Dharamshala in Himachal Kangra area, this is a place which you must visit. Not many people know about it. Not many people visit, sadly, but this is a absolute treasure trove to visit this place. Just imagine traveling, walking on the road where people who came from 4th century BC had walked, and they were still walking on the same path. This is the feeling that I had when I went to Turkey, because again, those 1200 years old city, Istanbul, and the same road is still existing, and I was walking on the same roads. So the same feeling we'll get here when you are in Kangra. Now, Kangra is again beautiful. You know, Palampur has most of the tea estates, as I said. In Dharamshala, there's only one tea estate called the Dharamshala Tea Factory. And it doesn't have many tea bungalows as such, but there are a lot of beautiful properties around where you can stay. A lot of activities you can do. Those properties actually offer a lot of beautiful activities that you can participate in. And of course, it's a beautiful place. Dharamshala has the Tibet head office. This Dalai Lama is there. So you can, and if you're lucky, we'll also meet Richard Gere, who has a house in Dharamshala. So just have to keep your fingers crossed. And the mountain here is called the Dhauladhar Mountain. This is a part of Himalaya, the Lesser Himalaya. And that's how here it is. Trekking, walking, picnic, all these things are part of the activities that you can think of here. Now, this is what I truly believe, that tea tourism in India is a fascinating way to explore country, because they are situated in different parts of the country, you know, north, south, east, not in west, but north, south, east. They are like situated in different parts of the world, and you can stay in some of the beautiful bungalows. Like in Darjeeling, there's a bungalow called the Singtom Bungalow, which is the oldest tea resort in the world. It was started in 1862, so you can actually stay in that bungalow, which is the oldest tea resort in the world, inaugurated in 1862. So these are some of the things which are extremely, you know, you will not find this kind of experiences anywhere else when you're doing something else. And stay in those bungalows, experience the local life. When I was in Nilgiris, you saw some pictures of the tribal people. So we went and spent half a day with the tribal people, the Todas and the Bagadas. And we ate food with them. We danced with them in the temple. We stayed at their home. We had a lot of fun. You know, we played football with them, with their kids. So it was a really experience that we had. And then in the whole process, you also get to know about the beautiful beverage called tea. And that tea is not absolutely comparable when it comes to, in terms of health, in terms of varieties, in terms of complexities. Tea is one of the most So that is it. The end of the presentation.
What a wonderful presentation discussing about the whole concept of tea tourism in India. I think so. Tea is as well as like we go for the wine tasting, we should go for the tea tasting also.
Wine tasting, see, we are not really known for the best wine producers in the world, right? Though we have good wines, we have some of the wines that are very good coming from Nashik and from Bangalore, but they are not the world famous. The world famous wine come from France, Italy, Germany, and those places.
Exactly.
But we have world famous teas.
We have world famous teas in India.
And so definitely need to do a lot of tea appreciation and tea tasting.
So coming on to the last session, there's like few questions which people are asking. There's one question from Mr. Vignesh Iyer. He wants to say that seeing the current time, what how we build immunity, which tea is best for building the immunity?
See, this is a question a lot of people are asking. There's a research that has been done in the USA. And if you visit my blog in my website, there's a blog on this subject as well. So the research says that if you drink 5 cups of black tea every day, you can improve your immunity. And this is not a comparison. And they compared it with coffee and other beverages. They said that if coffee doesn't happen, with tea, if you have the nice black whole tea brewed properly, not cooked, brewed, and without milk and sugar, if you can have 5 cups a day, you can improve your immunity. I drink 5 cups, more than 5 cups of tea every day. I have no immunity, so what else is doing?
I think that's we a suggestion. Like in India, we are habit of drinking milk tea, which is like more not brewed. It is like we cook the tea.
So I was telling you the difference between tea and chai, right?
Yeah.
Tea is something which you brew. That means you boil the water, then you take the tea leaf, you put the hot water into the tea leaf. Let it infuse for about 2-3 minutes and then strain that tea and you drink as it is without milk or sugar. So that is the brewing process. When you brew tea like this, it becomes tea. Now, chai is when you cook. What happens in chai is that you have water, you have milk, you have sugar, you put some masalas, whatever, and you put CPC tea and you boil. Right? Now, here what happens is, number one, all the goodness of the tea is gone. And number two is that this is not a very healthy tea for you. Milk, sugar, etc. causes a lot of harm to people when you are taking it like this. Yes, we are used to drinking karak chai, masala chai, all these things are good. But if you look from the health perspective, you cannot have chai, you have to have tea.
That's exactly the difference between the chai and the tea.
Yes, so chai tea is brewed.
Yeah, so we got dear viewers, we have launched the poll. So please rate our session from excellent to poor in whatever category you suit, whatever you think that our session was. Please rate your remarks in the poll. And one more thing, it is said that tea, when we drink tea, it creates an acidity in our stomach. Is it true?
It creates an acidity in the stomach only when you are mixing it with milk.
Okay.
And that also, like some of the black tea, like Assam tea or Second Fresh Darjeeling tea or some Nilgiris tea, you need to mix a little bit of milk. But that is like not boiling it. So after the tea has been brewed, you take 1 teaspoon of milk and put it on the tea. But what we do is we boil milk, water, sugar, and tea together. Now, if you take this as a concentration, 100% concentration of water, milk, sugar, and tea, 99% would be milk, sugar, and tea, sugar, and only 1% would be tea in the whole concentration, right?
Exactly.
Now, so if only 1% is tea, can you call it a tea?
No.
So we are doing something wrong. We are drinking a chai flavored tea, chai flavored milk. Like we have strawberry flavored milk, we have peach mango flavor, we are having a chai flavored.
Chai flavored milk.
Yeah, we are not having chai, we are not having tea. It's a flavored milk. And if you drink too much of flavored milk, you will have acidity problem because milk is lactose. Some people are lactose intolerant. And it causes digestion in people if you are drinking milk not in the right way. So it is not a blame on the tea leaf. It is the way we are making and drinking the tea.
Exactly. What it differs from the how you're making, how you're brewing the tea. I'm not saying how you're brewing the tea.
Brewing the tea is very important. The right way of brewing. See, white, green, oolong, black, they all have very different brewing processes. So whatever you drink, you have to follow the exact process of brewing.
Is there anything like we say that ki din mein itni hi chai piya kare? Somewhat, if you say it.
As I said, 5 cups of tea is good for you in terms of building your immunity. And let me tell you one thing. I'll give you a reference. You see the Japanese people, you see the Chinese people, do you see how long they live? Do you see their skin? Do you see their hair? Japanese, in Japan, there is a place called Okinawa where the people live at least 100 years. And you know why? Because in those places, they carry their tea leaves and hot water with them all the time. They do not drink water. All through the day, they drink only green tea.
Exactly.
So, it's not bad for your health. You can have as much of tea as you like, provided you are drinking it the right way.
So I think so. It is like 5 cups of tea, a black tea. I am not saying chai. 5 cups of black tea or Darjeeling tea or green tea. I think so. It is a good thing which we can start building our immunity and all.
Any tea, let me tell you this: if you drink white tea, also it is good for you. Green tea also is good for you. Long. Is not available that much. Green black tea is available. So you can have a mixture of, you know, morning you can have a green tea because it helps in the metabolism and stuff like that. White tea you can have in the evening. 2 cups of black tea in between. So you can have a mixture of teas if you want. But if you do not have that kind of tea in your storage, then stick to black tea or green tea and drink it. It doesn't matter. You can drink it in place of water. Chinese people drink tea in place of water.
So, I think so. I'm very thankful to Susmita for such a very good session on tea tourism. Like, we just saw that, we just thought that ki tea jo aati hai, sirf Assam se aati hai and Darjeeling se aati hai. But we have a whole lot of varieties of tea which are available in the parts of the country. And I think so, to all our viewers, it is an opinion that we go to different countries to taste the wines. We go for a wine testing session. Why not go for a tea testing session where we have world's best tea?
Yes.
World's best tea, the Darjeeling tea or the champagne of the tea in the India. Yes. So it is. It, we should feel proud of it that we have the world's best tea with us.
Yes, and, exactly.
And why not explore the tea tourism in India?
Exactly. Yes.
So this was a great session by Susmita. I must thank you for such a beautiful session, taking her to the tea estates and exploring the tea gardens and the process of the tea. So our viewers, please stay connected with us at the same time at 7 a.m. for tomorrow. Tomorrow we'll take you to the lovely dinosaur land or the Jurassic Park of India. So please stay connected with us and keep watching our sessions. The sessions are live recorded and they are available on Facebook for us. Thank you and have a nice day.
Yes. Thank you so much. Thank you. See you. Bye.